Sorry to tell you that Eric Stewart left the English pop beat group from Manchester, England, called the Mind Benders. So did Bob Lang and Rick Rothwell. After they had a final concert of a UK tour with a pop rock band, The Who, with members Roger Daltrey and his friend Peter Townsend, Arthur Brown, and pop rock singer Joe Cocker. So Mr. Eric Stewart went on his own to become a studio recording engineer at Strawberry Studios in Stockport, England, with future studio secretary Miss Kathy Redfern.
Eric was a bit of a star in his own right. But I think more than anything else, he wanted to be a producer, an engineer, and very smartly he sort of partnered with a guy in the local music shop, and they laboriously set up what became Strawberry Studios.
He'd found this old building in the middle of Stockport and started to turn it into a studio. We're doing it ourselves with hammers and nails. It's incredible. And we started with a very little control desk and two stereo machines, and Strawberry Studios opened and we started getting work. So I went from the Mindbenders to being an engineer at Strawberry.
For some reason, he got in touch with myself and Lol to come and help him test the first version of the studio. And we just tried some stuff, really, to test the capabilities of the new equipment.
You needed somebody that would bang drums endlessly for hours on end while he fiddled and, you know, finessed the noise to get a good drum sound. Even Kevin was beginning to fade. So I went in and I sat on the floor with an acoustic guitar, and I sat in front of the bass drum and I started strumming any old stuff just to keep Kevin buoyant, really, so they could keep banging. And Eric was very enthusiastic. I said, just a bit more, just a bit more. and at some point, to keep me occupied, I started singing this nursery rhyme that sort of came spontaneously.
It was simply a test, but a guy, a music publisher, swung by and heard what we were doing and said, it's a smash. People actually did say things like that in those days. And we promptly wiped it by mistake. Erased it, and I had to start again from scratch.
As you know, this song by Hot Legs that reached number 2 in the UK on the 15th of August 1970 and remained there for 2 weeks, kept off the top spot by Elvis Presley's The Wonder of You, entitled Neanderthal Man is not my favorite. As far as I'm concerned, I always forbid both foul language, cursing, and profanity. I don't like vulgar, explicit, sexual-oriented, erotic, racy, risque, sexually suggestive stuff that is not made for a sweet and innocent girl like me. I like a lot of wholesome, family-oriented stuff that's made pure.
We got it slightly better because we knew what we were doing a bit. And indeed, that's how Neanderthal Man was made. And it was released and it was a hit everywhere.
The studio was getting more professional after Neanderthal Man was a hit. We were being booked all the time. And Graham Gouldman had been working in America. When he heard that we were actually working together with people, he joined our backing group team.
Essentially, we were four disparate guys who became a house band for the various
acts that came through the door of Strawberry Studios. And it was, I don't know, it was more like Broadway Danny Rose than rock and roll. There were some pretty bizarre people came through that door. We found ourselves doing music for football teams and TV producers' girlfriends, ventriloquists, and God knows what else. So it was a crash course in being versatile.
I remember Harvey Lisberg, Graham's manager, persuaded Neil Sedaka, who had had his hits in the 50s and had a pretty dry run in the 60s, he was pretty much out of favour. He sold Neil on these great guys at Strawberry Studios in Manchester that could produce wonderful material for him.
Neil was actually due to make a new record and had all this material. And I think the idea was he'd come over and do like two or three songs. But it worked like magic, and we all got on very well, and Neil did the whole album. That's when the
music takes me. We did five hit singles, I think, and a couple of hit albums. He came back again. And it was Neil said, you should keep working on your own material because you deserve to have some hits. You're good. And he encouraged us.
I've no idea why we never thought of it before, but we didn't. And it was only after we'd finished the album with Neil Sedaka that we decided that we should become a band. Eric and I had written a song called Waterfall that Apple Records, the Beatles record company, were interested in putting out. So we thought, well, in case they do, let's get everything ready. And because Eric and I had written the A side, we thought it was fair that Kevin and Lol should write the B side.
So we went next door to the control room and knocked out Donna. We came and recorded it, and everyone, when we'd finished that, we thought, well, maybe this is even more commercial than Waterfall.
I never like the early Neil Sedaka from the 50s and the 60s, where he did a song called Oh Carol, in which he had no vibrato in the beginning. So I like the later Neil Sedaka from the 70s, until 1980, when he did my favorite tune, I Hear Laughter in the Rain.
Donna was a sort of pastiche of 50s doo-wop. And Eric had the bright idea of asking Jonathan King to come down and have a listen to it, which he subsequently did and again said, it's a smash. People still said those kind of things.
I said, are you serious? He said, yeah, it's a smash. What's the name of the band? I said, we haven't got a name. So he said, well, this is really weird, Eric. Last night I had a dream and I saw a poster and it said, 10cc, the greatest group in the world. I said, okay, sounds great to me, the greatest group in the world. I'll ask the guys. And they said, yeah, okay, is he offering us a deal? I said, yeah. He offered us a deal and we signed up with him. And he released that record, Donna, a number two, from nowhere.
After Donna, we put out another single called Johnny Don't Do It that completely bombed. It was in a similar vein to Donna. It was another pastiche. And maybe we would, enough with the pastiche already. You did it. You did it once.
So we cleared the slate to start again. And the next thing we wrote was Rubber Bullets. And that just seemed to have a life of its own when we recorded it and finished it. And it was an even bigger hit. Donna went to number two and Rubber Bullets actually went to number one. It was our first number one.
I always loved. I think it's just a hilarious song and really smart and really clever and yeah, something joyful about it. You know, it's that kind of brilliant, super poppy, with this nuts idea for a song. You know, like it's a crazy idea, lyrically. Roll out, rubber bullets. It's like, what are you on about? It's mad, but brilliant. You know, why would you do that in a pop song? But they did, and they got away with it.
Amazing directions that we were taking musically came mostly from Godley and Creme. You would just come up with the most ridiculous idea, but eventually you would not say, we can't do that, that's ridiculous. You would say, let's try it.
It was a very sort of energized atmosphere in the studio because we had these sort of basically two writing teams, and Eric and I had been in one room, Kevin and Lola be in another room, and like whoever finished the song first would go, we got one, and we'd listen to it and we'd play it to the other boys and they'd come up with suggestions and changes.
It certainly was a chemical reaction and we were lucky, but I think part of the reason it worked out so well is because we positioned ourselves so that no one could interfere. We were out of the limelight, we were away from London, we were a little studio in Stockport of all places. And probably no one even knew we were there, so we could just mess around and play and experiment. But in the eyes of the dean, his daughter was do what she shouldn't order. But a man's gotta do what a man's gotta do. The consequence should be.
I remember listening to the Dean and I when Kevin and Lol played it for us. It was just such an amazing song. I could almost say, if anything represented 10cc, it was that song. It had everything. I mean, there are so many musical changes in it. The chords are amazing. I've never heard anything like it since.
I hated that song. I hated the Dean and I, because I really wasn't very, very fond of American musicals. I always thought it was a bit cheesy, you know. What have we got? We ain't got Danes, oh, and all that stuff. And I thought, all right, I'm going to go along and record this because, you know, we're a very democratic group. I thought, but how can I do something different in this? So I put some blues guitar in it, and it fattened it up and it put some balls into it.
It's so anti his influences, which is sort of rock and roll and blues. And this came from Doris Day and South Pacific and Rodgers and Hammerstein and that whole genre. So it was a world away. And we didn't see any barriers, we didn't see any reason why we shouldn't.
We wrote those songs because we wrote that. I don't know why we wrote songs like that, but what we were into was harmony. We liked singing, we liked testing our, and we had the facility, we had the time to try and get harmonies right. We didn't have anybody breathing down our necks. We sort of gravitated towards that kind of stuff, just naturally.
Did stuff. There was very little thought. It was about doing as opposed to thinking. And the first album, I think, was written and recorded in 3 weeks, which sounds crazy these days, because people labour and craft and hone and carve, smooth and polish. We didn't, we just did it. And it was all the better for it, because what came out was pure us. It's a wonderful world when you're rolling in dollars.
The writing of the songs was very important to us all in those days, and it became the form that when you had a separate kind of colour in the writing, it was worth trying a different vocal colour. By that, I mean either a harmony or a different lead voice or any combination that we could figure out.
Well, as you know, Donna, Johnny Don't Do It, Life is a Minestrone, Silly Love, the plain, soulless, original version of The Wall Street Shuffle from their second album, Sheet Music. The Dean and I and Rubber Bullets, that was later banned for the duration of the Persian Gulf War, are not my favorites. So I like the BBC sophistopop version of Wall Street Shuffle that is made for dancing.
We used to have a system of, because we'd all like to try out for the vocals, mostly, but to save time, you know, we'd go into the studio and someone would sing on this particular song. Then we'd have a sign that just said next,